This next presentation is on infant and childhood homeopathic remedies, as simple as A, B, C, P. Well, I'll explain that shortly. But first, I want to give some attention to Bob Weir and his wife, Natasha, who, when I was writing my book, The Homeopathic Revolution, about famous people that use homeopathic medicine, their pediatrician is a homeopath, and she alerted them that I was writing a book of this nature about famous people and what they did with homeopathy, and they wanted to be a part of it. Because as they told me, they've used homeopathy around 50 different times for their two kids, and each time they've had remarkable results. So when I asked them if they had individually a specific quote that they could give me, they both said the exact same thing. And it was really great for a rock and roll. If you don't know Bobby Weir, he's one of the guitarists for the Grateful Dead. And they both said, I don't know how parents do without homeopathy. I don't know. This gave me some serious street cred to have this wonderful lunch with them and for them to give this type of punch to 2 and 4 homeopathy. And it seems appropriate then that I'd use that story to talk about some important infant and childhood remedies that we use in homeopathy. And here is where I bet you you're going to use homeopathy a lot too. If not to treat your own children, maybe to treat your own grandchildren. And of course, one of the great things about homeopathy and dealing with infants and children is that homeopathic medicines are so much safer than conventional drugs. So homeopathic medicines really honor that tradition, that Hippocratic tradition of first do no harm. And you have to remember that even from a conventional medical point of view, infants and children metabolize drugs differently than adults do. And often pediatricians reduce the dose based on body size. But that still is a very crude way of determining what is the most optimal and safe dose for infants and children. Because what may be relatively safe for an adult to take is not so safe for an infant, let alone a child. You may have heard, for instance, that some children who get fevers and are given aspirin to lower the fever can develop this neurological condition, which can be very dangerous and even lead to death, called Reye's syndrome. And at other times, when an infant is given certain drugs that are being used to treat nausea, those too can be very dangerous because it can lead to dehydration, which can also lead to infant death. Then, as a child gets older, even in teenage, there's a popular conventional medicine that is given to treat people with the flu called Tamiflu. And it's so dangerous for children, for teenagers specifically, that in Japan, doctors are banned for prescribing this Tamiflu drug for teenagers because it's been found to lead to suicidal ideation. In other words, it gives them ideas for suicide. So, homeopathic medicines, honoring this first do no harm tradition in medicine, can and should be first considered, especially in treating simple conditions for which conventional medicine really offers little itself anyway. Teething, colic, earache. Of course, conventional doctors do recommend certain antibiotics, but even the American Academy of Pediatrics today is discouraging antibiotic usage unless the child has had a much more serious ear infection or it has been going on for multiple weeks, sometimes even multiple months. And even common simple fevers of infants and children, you have to be careful of using conventional medicines. You can talk with your own doctor about this and get his or her sense about what they recommend. But in addition to whatever they recommend, you can be using some of the following homeopathic medicines. So I remember this talk was called Infant and Childhood Homeopathic Medicines, as simple as A, B, C, P. Well, the A stands for aconitum. And aconitum is made from the herb monkshood. And this is actually a medicine that patients use more themselves than homeopathic doctors prescribe, because this is for the very first stage of an infection. And in fact, sometimes by the time they've gone to the doctor, they're already beyond that first stage. So at the very first stage of a simple fever, where there's just a fever and may not have any other symptoms, you may not have a sore throat, may not have a cough, may not have an earache, may not have, you know, musculoskeletal pain, just a fever. This is one of the medicines that we consider, especially if they happen to get this initial stage of the infection after being exposed to cold or a change in the weather. Now, of course, it is a myth that it's not that cold causes an infection. It doesn't. A virus or bacteria cause an infection. But what the cold or change of weather does is it stresses the infant or child. It forces the child's body to adapt. And sometimes, if there are other stresses in the child, infant or child at that time, that cumulative assortment of stresses and the exposure to a bacteria or virus itself to combine can lead to a particular problem. So one of the things you might notice just subtly is the child is more fidgety, more restless. They may even have an increased thirst. Now, one of the other indications for using aconitum is after some type of fright or even some type of natural disaster. So if something has happened where the child has gone through something like this and then develops a fever or a common cold or a sore throat, aconitum is one of the key remedies. Now, the next medicine I want to talk about is belladonna. And you'll see some similar but also some different symptoms of it. Now, belladonna is made from a botanical medicine called deadly nightshade. And deadly nightshade does sound dangerous, doesn't it? And it is, if you were to take the tincture, and of course, you can't even purchase the tincture in America, it's a prescription drug. But in homeopathic doses, it can and will be used for certain types of infections. And the difference here in the people that need belladonna, the infants and children that need belladonna, is there's usually a sudden onset of a fever, usually. The child is dry, red, and hot. The face might even become red. The lips may become redder than normal. The person and the child may become hypersensitive to the senses, to light, to touch, to jar. The pain that child may experience, there'll be an ebb and flow of pain, of certain pain syndromes come and then go. So this also could be teething that could even be going on. But one of the things that's different is that the person, the child, the infant or child will have a dry mouth, dry throat, dry tongue and nose. Like I said, there'll be this redness. Even the tongue will be redder than normal. The mouth, the face itself will be, I won't say beet red, because that's only in the more severe cases, but redder than normal. And there very well may be a higher fever of above 101. Now, I recommend that you consult with your doctor to determine at what point you might want to seek medical care. But often you do not need to seek medical care. It depends upon the age of the infant or child and the real height of the fever. But a great deal of fevers you can treat yourself with homeopathic medicine, even on your way to the doctor. One of the other indications for using belladonna is you may have heard that belladonna is even a hallucinogen. In fact, some folklore has it that if you take some of the belladonna flowers, which look like lovely lampshades, it's this beautiful flower that points down to the ground. But you take some of the flowers, and if you were to put it under your pillow, just breathing it in can and will influence your dreams. If you were to take it internally, which of course I don't recommend, it is a toxic particular botanical, but it's known to create wild dreaming, and infants that that benefit from homeopathic doses of belladonna complain about dreams being scary, or they're seeing monsters in their closet or in their room. And this is quite common when children have a moderate or medium or higher fever, and when they have an earache, sore throat, or teething, and with these wild dreams and this fright, fear of scary things, belladonna is the first remedy to come to mind. One of the great things about belladonna is that when you give it in a homeopathic dose, the results are very dramatic and very fast. I mean, usually within 5 or 10 minutes, if it is the right remedy, whatever fever that that child has will be gone. And that's the thing that really always parents appreciate and has them gravitate towards homeopathy and use homeopathy on a regular basis, because the results that people get often are quite dramatic. And the fact that they work in such a dramatic way on infants who don't seem to have any belief one way or the other and are simply put some medicine in their mouth and shortly thereafter get improvement is evidence of homeopathy's power. So aconite A, belladonna B, C stands for chamomilla. And chamomilla is one of our leading medicines we give to infants during teething and colic episodes, also for certain earaches. But the difference here is this is an infant that will be highly irritable and cross, maybe even have what we commonly think of as a temper tantrum. And that might not just be from the teething, it might be from a lot of gas that they may have, and they may be holding their tummy, screaming for attention. These are the type of infants that want to be held and want to be rocked. And just as they fall asleep in your hands and your arms, and you then put them down in their bed, they wake up again and they want your attention again. So this is an indication for using chamomilla. And you'll find that not only will they fall asleep in your arms, but as you put them down, they will often stay asleep. Once again, indication that something has worked. So some other indications for chamomilla is the infant will have a tummy that will be sensitive to touch. You'll see the child doubling up, curling into a ball. They sometimes will kick and scream. Remember, they do get relief by being held and by being rocked. So sometimes they need to be held and rocked. Sometimes many parents take their child for a ride in the car. With what just that rocking that happens from the motion of the car is often enough to help put a child to sleep. And of course, chamomilla helps too. This is also the type of infant that seems to demand something. Maybe they're demanding to be breastfed, but then or want to be fed something in general. But then as soon as that is offered, they push it away. So the bottom line is that they're irritable. They're in pain and discomfort, and they're looking for something to provide relief. They don't know what they want either. Now, one of the other indications for chamomilla is that they have a sour smell about them. Sometimes it's the stools that are sour, sometimes it's the sweat that's sour, sometimes it's the little vomiting that is sour. So whenever you get this sour smelling infant that also is going through these temper tantrums and that feels better to be held and rocked, those are part of the picture of chamomilla. And new parents that are familiar with chamomilla, you know, have the highest regard for it. They keep it on hand. I remember the first time our child was born, and it was a long and difficult birth. And my wife's mother was over at our house. And here our baby was crying. And my wife's mother was holding it in her arms. And I said to myself, why am I not giving our baby chamomilla? And it was really great to put this homeopathic medicine right in my son's mouth. And as his grandmother was holding him, literally as soon as it hit his mouth, the baby stopped. And I mean, that was not just convincing to me. That was really greatly convincing to my wife's mother too. So sometimes it's helpful to have our family and extended family to see personally the results that homeopathy offers. So A, B, C, P. P stands for pulsatilla. And pulsatilla is another dream medicine that is commonly given in homeopathy, especially for infants and children. It also is given for adults, especially women, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. But pulsatilla is more often given based on its body-mind personality than the specific complaint. So this is a remedy that can and will be given for many ear infections or earaches that kids get, or respiratory infections, or allergies, or digestive problems, or even certain emotional issues. But this particular remedy is made from an herb called the windflower. And the windflower is a flower that ends up being one of the first flowers to send its pollen into the wind in springtime. And just like the pollen getting taken into the wind, this is a medicine who, for a child or an adult who also is taken into the wind easily and may have ups and down moods, will be happy one minute and sad the next. In any case, this is a person that will want attention and sympathy. And we all know infants and children that can and will want attention and sympathy. This is a child who is very impressionable. If he or she hears a scary story, they may have difficulty sleeping. Now, that won't happen with an infant, but more often what we see in infants is that the infant actually will go through a stage where they won't be thirsty. They may not want water, may not even be hungry and want a breast. They can and will be what we call warm-blooded. Now, all human beings are warm-blooded, but the specific meaning that we have for the term warm-blooded in homeopathy is that the infant, child, or adult tends to be warmer. In other words, they like cool air around them. This is the type of person that throws covers off, may take socks off, may take clothes off, prefers windows open, is averse to warm rooms. The other indication for pulsatilla infants and children is that these are very sweet human beings, these little balls of love that want attention, they want sympathy, they're very loving. This is a very common personality as compared to the chamomilla, which can and will be irritable and can and will throw temper tantrums. It's very easy to see the differences here. So to summarize these four homeopathic medicines for infants and children, we have aconite and belladonna, chamomilla, and pulsatilla. The aconite and belladonna are for often some of these fevers that children get, sometimes these respiratory infections, or sometimes an ear infection for the very first stages of it. Chamomilla for that first and or second stage of teething or colic, that irritable child, as compared to the sweet child of pulsatilla, who may be in pain and might be having this sweet crying, this sweet weeping that you'll want to give attention to and sympathy to. And both chamomilla, you'll want to rock and you'll actually notice some benefits. Chamomilla, the pulsatilla child and infant will want to be rocked. But the difference is that the chamomilla will be crying from an irritable, whereas the pulsatilla may be just weepy and a sweet weep, not out of as much pain, though they can and will have pain if they have that earache and or some digestive disorders, but it'll be a sweet type of crying. So these four remedies, young parents will use very frequently for the first several years of their life. You'll be forever grateful that you've learned about homeopathy. You'll see some great results with it. And you and your family will be a lot healthier and happier knowing about them.